Thank you, Tony. It's a pleasure to do this too. I mean, it's not very often you get to talk to a captive audience about the things that you really enjoy doing. And I try to avoid doing this sometimes when I have to do school matters, but anyway. I'll turn the lights down a little bit, I think, because the slides might show up a little bit better. This is, of course, UWA, and this is the Bayliss building where the School of Chemistry and Biochemistry resides at the moment. It's coming up for 10 years, Tony, so we'll be hopefully having a celebration next year for its 10th birthday.
Can you ask for another building?
No. No, we're extremely well off. Just a few points about the International Year of Crystallography. It's 2014. It's a little bit late, actually, because it's intended to commemorate the centennial of X-ray diffraction, which was really about 1912, 1913. But it also commemorates the 400th anniversary of Kepler's observation of the symmetrical shape of ice crystals, in particular snow. And I'll talk a little bit about that as I go through, but I just wanted to point out some of the goals of this year. There are many of them on the website. One of them is to increase public awareness of the science of crystallography, and we're doing a little bit of that here. We've got a few things I'll talk about right at the end of the talk. We are trying to inspire young people through public exhibitions and so forth. But down here, to illustrate the universality of science, so there are a lot of activities all around the world. And if you go to the IYCR 2014 website, you'll see activities across Australia, around the world. So what am I doing today? I'm trying to, if you like, give you a little bit more awareness, the public, of crystallography and what it is. But one thing that's common to what I've been doing for quite a while now is contained in this quote here. And this is something that you'll see every now and again on the web. The important thing in science is not so much to obtain new facts as to discover new ways of thinking about them. And some of my experimental colleagues disagree with that one. They think that that's not really true. It's interesting, actually, if you try to find the origin of that quote, because there is no prime source except for this one here. It's actually a book published in the 60s. Which actually doesn't quote Bragg directly, and in fact it doesn't even say which Bragg they're talking about. But it actually says it served as an illustration, this is a particular symposium, of Bragg's statement that the important thing in science, etc., etc. So like a lot of things that are taken for granted, if you try and track back to where they came from, there's no idea about which Bragg it was, no idea about whether that was actually what he said, but anyway, it's become one of these sort of myths on the web. But it's a nice observation. So what we've been doing for quite a long time now, since, I don't know, 15 or more years, is look at crystals, molecular crystals, differently. So what I want to do tonight is talk about crystal packing, and I'm going to go back to 1611 and even further. Talk about something that we've developed called the Hirschfeld surface, and then use it in an analysis of three molecular crystals that have been important in the history of crystallography. So, the first part. I'll start with Dorothy Hodgkin. Now, Dorothy Hodgkin was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 1964 for, as it says, this is the citation, her determinations by X-ray techniques of the structures of important biochemical substances. So the point here, of course, is that almost all of the three-dimensional information we have about the shapes, the structures of small molecules, large molecules, biomolecules, has come from X-ray diffraction techniques. Dorothy Hodgkin was only the third woman awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. And the structures that she sold were among, well, the penicillin and vitamin B12 were among the most important. Anyway, in 1960, she actually gave one of 10 tercentenary lectures to the Royal Society. And the title of her lecture was Molecules and Crystals. Now, I didn't copy it from her. I actually tried to come up with a title for a talk, and I thought Molecules and Crystals is what I do. And when you Google that particular phrase, this is what you come up with. And I thought that was really quite neat. So what did she do? She actually said, on this occasion, I wish to describe the structures as we see them today, now bear in mind that's over 50 years ago, of a number of very remarkable crystals. These would certainly have interested the early fellows of the Royal Society, particularly perhaps Hooke and Boyle, both of whom carried out experiments on growing crystals, observed the shapes of their faces, and speculated on the arrangement of corpuscles within. So here's Hooke's book, Robert Hooke, 1665. This is an imagined portrait of Hooke. There are no existing portraits of Robert Hooke anywhere. The story is that Newton and he, well, Newton was jealous of Hooke and apparently had all portraits, any images of Hooke, destroyed. I don't know how true it is, but it's an interesting story. There are quite a lot of them attached to this sort of talk. Anyway, Hooke published an astonishing book at the time, 1665. And those of you who came to Stephen Curry's lecture 4 weeks ago, he talked about this as well. And he actually pointed out this is the book where that famous illustration of the flea comes from. So he actually spent a lot of time looking through microscopes and telescopes and actually wrote down and in quite incredible detail displayed images of things that were very, very small. But one of the things that he looked at was actually crystals. And this is a page from his book. And he talked about alum crystals. And he, of course, made the connection between the shape of the crystals and the way in which objects inside them must be packed to give that shape. And he actually was playing around with this idea of bullets. And he says, if globular bullets will of themselves, if put on an inclining plane, so that they may run together, naturally run into a triangular order. And everybody's seen this. I mean, just something like peas. If you drop frozen peas onto a surface, they'll do the same sort of thing. Composing all the variety of figures that can be imagined, these ones here, made out of equilateral triangles. And such you'll find upon trial the surfaces of alum to be composed of. So he's making this connection in 1665 between objects that must sit inside here, even though you can't see them, that explain those angles and plane faces of the crystals. But he also recognized that if you stack these layers up in three dimensions, you can start to explain the shape, not just the shape of the face, but the shape of the crystal. So it doesn't only hold in superficies, but in solidity also. For it's obvious that a fourth globule, laid upon the third, composes a regular tetrahedron. And he actually then started looking at, the shape of salt crystals. Everybody knows what a salt crystal looks like. It's a perfect cube. It's quite beautiful. For instance, also in the figure of sea salt, it's composed of a texture of globules placed in a cubical form, as in L, down here. So, he was the first person to propose the internal structure of common salt was cubic. But what's really interesting is that Hooke made absolutely no reference to the work of Kepler. And Kepler preceded him by 50-odd years. And as I pointed out at the beginning, the International Year of Crystallography is, among other things, celebrating Kepler's work from 1611. Now, Kepler, this is a rather beautiful little essay, if you like. It's a pamphlet that he produced for his patron. And there are some nice English translations available on the web. Much easier to read than these. But among them, you'll find these rather interesting diagrams, which look a lot like Hooke's, even though Kepler made no reference to Hooke whatsoever. What did Kepler do? He was actually thinking about the shape of snowflakes. That is, why do they have a regular six-fold shape? And he started to think about the shape of objects. And he said, are there any bodies similar to the five regular solids and the 14 Archimedean solids that could be constructed with nothing but rhombi, that is, objects like this, faces of equal edge, but not square, squashed, if you like. And he said he found two, one with affinities to the cube and octahedron, that's this one here, and the other to the dodecahedron and icosahedron, this one here. And the simplest of these is what's called the rhombic dodecahedron. And he goes on to describe the way in which it's related to, believe it or not, the way in which cells interlock in honeycomb, and even more indirectly to the seeds inside pomegranates. Remember, he started off talking about the shape of snow crystals. He published another book, The Harmony of the World, in 1619, where he presented these objects again. But the idea about these honeycomb is really a fascinating one, because I don't know whether you've actually looked at honeycomb carefully. It's actually got back-to-back cells. It's not just one layer of cells, it's got back-to-back cells. And the cells don't actually meet in a flat plane, they actually interlock. And what Kepler did was he recognized that if you actually took the cells and capped them in the same way, you end up with effectively, if you squash it a bit, a rhombic dodecahedron. So Kepler was talking about building up space by regular objects of this kind. But he went a little bit further, because he noticed that if you look at pomegranates, you get this sort of array of regular objects that appear like they've been squeezed together inside the shell. And he started talking about loculi. Notice he's not talking about molecules or atoms or anything, just something specified by that word. And he said, well, if they start out small and separate inside the pomegranate, and then they grow and grow and grow, but they're restricted in their growth by the hard shell of the pomegranate. So eventually they'll grow to the point where they pretty much exhaust all of space. And he then thought, well, obviously the arrangement of these objects there will depend on the initial arrangement of the seeds. So he said, what if you enclose in a round vessel a number of round pellets of equal size and of soft stuff, and then tighten it all around? And he postulated that the pellets would be squeezed into this rhomboid shape. And, of course, the shapes will depend on the original arrangement of the pellets. And he identified two different packings. Well, actually, he was wrong. He's only got one of them, just looked at differently. But he said packing layers such that these pellets touch four neighbours above and below, one will be touched by 12, and under pressure, spherical pellets will become rhomboid. And he said this packing will be the tightest possible. And that's now known as the Kepler conjecture. And the 3D array he described is actually what we call face-centered cubic or cubic close packing. Okay. Now, these are diagrams of packing of cannonballs. That's cubic close packing. Why is it interesting here? Well, Kepler didn't actually discover it. It was actually described probably around about the late 16th century by Thomas Harriot, who was actually a mathematician who went with Walter Rayleigh to the New World. He actually learned Algonquin, and he went to America with Rayleigh. He was the only member of the team that actually knew the language of the natives. But he was an amazing person, and he actually described the FCC or CCP packing because he was actually telling Rayleigh how to most efficiently pack cannonballs on a ship. And this is it here. This is Alcatraz with the cannonballs. This is actually the American Civil War and the packing of cannonballs. If you like, it's a very, very early application of defense research or applied research. Pure research for a very obvious end. Now, what I would put to you is that Kepler's insight was pretty incredible. This is over 400 years ago. Because he wasn't just thinking about the arrangement of the spheres, he was actually thinking about the space occupied by points in space. And this partitioning now is very commonly used in physics. It's what we call a Vignesite cell or a Voronoi partitioning. And it's just basically taking an arrangement of points like this. These are the points, the black dots. And if you divide the distance between them in half and draw a line perpendicular to that distance, and then assume that you can draw a space around each object, that's the Voronoi partition in two dimensions. And these are just examples of it from the Museum of Mathematics in New York and objects in an art gallery. Okay, so that's partitioning space. I will get to molecules and crystals, I promise. There's another equally dense sphere packing, hexagonal close packing. And the fascinating thing is that Kepler described cubic close packing in 1611, but it took until 1883 before hexagonal close packing was described. And it's really very simple. If you take a layer of spheres, balls, whatever, close packed in this arrangement here, and if you place the next layer on top of it in any way, it doesn't really matter, you end up with what we'd call an AB sequence. If you place the third layer immediately above the first layer, you get cubic close packing. If you place the third layer not above the first layer, but over here in that spot, you get hexagonal close packing. And there are only two ways to do this. But Barlow was the first to describe this. Why is Barlow important? Barlow comes up in this lecture several times. In 1883, Barlow was probably the last of the gentleman scientists. He was in his 30s, I think, when his father died and left a rather large fortune to him and his brother. And he basically spent the rest of his life doing science. He didn't have to go apply for grants. He didn't have to have an academic career. He worked at home and he wrote papers and he communicated with scientists at the time. I don't think anybody can do that these days. But there was an obituary written by a colleague of his, William Pope, in 1935. And it says something very important. Pope said, "The recognition that equilibrium demands that similar spherical atoms shall arrange themselves in one or other of the two closest packed assemblages, and that these occur in many of the metals, was the first definite success achieved in associating specific geometrical structures with specific crystalline substances." The importance of this result has been too little appreciated. So Barlow's work built on a lot of things that went before it, but he came up with something new. And you'll see later on that Barlow's work was absolutely instrumental in what Bragg did and why Bragg got a Nobel Prize. So that's a little bit of background on the history, going back from the late 16th century all the way up to the late 19th century. The Hirschfeld surface. We were interested back in around 1996 in partitioning molecular crystals into molecules. That is, finding out a way of actually wrapping a molecule, if you like, in a surface that was dictated by its neighbors. We're interested in the electron density of the molecules. And we came up with a rather interesting way of doing that, and we submitted it to Nature. And of course, like, I don't know how many percent, 95, 99% of papers to Nature, it was rejected. And they actually said, you know, "We don't doubt the value of results, et cetera, et cetera. But in particular, it's not obvious to us that your new formalism promises to provide new insights into the relationship between molecular structure and physical and chemical properties of the sort that a general reader might find illuminating." The paper that they rejected has been cited almost 300 times. So, yeah, you don't give up on those sorts of things. You just go ahead and pursue what you want to do. What are the ideas behind it? The idea is based on an electron density of an atom. Atoms are conceptually these objects. That is, there's a nucleus in the middle and some sort of an electron cloud surrounding the atom. And isolated atoms, you can average and call them spherical. But the electron density decays rapidly from a peak at the nucleus down to something within a certain distance away. And all the atoms have a different electron density. Fred Hirschfeld, in 1977, talked about ways in which you could actually use just as spherical atoms, that is, not even atoms bonded to one another, but spherical atoms, to actually approximate the electron density in a molecule. And it's a very good approximation. It's the one that almost all crystallographers use every day. He defined this thing he called a promolecule and just said, what if I compose something that's just a sum of electron densities of atoms, isolated, unperturbed, no bonding, just put them together. Okay. And he said, I'd like to split up this true electron density into atomic fragments. And he said, if I create this weight function here and divide the atomic electron density by the sum of the atomic electron densities for the whole molecule, I get a weight function. It's a scalar function. It's between 0 and 1 everywhere. It's 1 near the nucleus, and it goes out to 0 quite quickly. And then, of course, the procrystal is just the same sort of thing as the promolecule, except it's summed over the whole crystal. That was 1977. Also in 1977, I've kept this for all sorts of reasons. I was a PhD student in 1977 here in the Crystallography Center and Chemistry at UWA. And the university was very good to me and gave me funding to go to my first international conference, which happened to be at the Weizmann Institute in Israel. And it was organized by Fred Hirschfeld. So these ideas come back again and again and again. I show this because I think it highlights the value of sending our students overseas to conferences as part of their PhD. It certainly had a big impact on me and dictated a lot of what I've done since. What did we do way back in 97? We said, okay, if you take this weight function, instead of the electron density of an atom divided by that of the promolecule, what if you take the electron density of the promolecule and divide it by the procrystal? Same sort of thing. What you end up with is a function that if you contour it around a benzene molecule, it's flat across the molecule, and then it drops very quickly and smoothly down to zero. This is how quickly it drops. It drops from 0.9 down to 0.5 down to 0.1, that far. And then we said, gee, that's interesting. I wonder what it would look like if you took the ICIS surface at a half. Because at a half, that defines, if you like, the space belonging to a molecule. And you can do that. And you can visualize it, and you can do all sorts of fun things with it, and I'll show you some of the things we've been doing. You can print these objects. There's a 3D printer here in computer science. You can print them and have fun with them. You can build them. But there's a direct relationship between these surfaces and going all the way back to Kepler's observations, because if you actually take a face-centered cubic or a hexagonal close-packed arrangement of atoms with just a spherical electron density surrounding them, and you construct the Hirschfeld surface, this particular surface, for this array, these two close-packed arrays, they look identical if you're looking down on the plane. But if you tilt it slightly, you actually get the two objects are quite different, because, of course, the difference between the layering is AB, AB, and ABC, ABC. And you end up with exactly the same shapes. This is the rhombic dodecahedron described all the way back by Kepler. Except here they're smooth. They don't exhaust all the space. And I've taken these diagrams here from a whole book on the Kepler conjecture, which has actually been now proven. Look at the date of it, though. It's been proven. I believe the proof is 285 pages long. All right, what do these things look like? It took us a long time to figure out how to do this, but anyway, this is a conventional, the color underneath is a conventional illustration of a molecule these days. It's called CPK, or actually space filling model. The Hirschfeld surface for this molecule, that doesn't matter too much what it is, wraps around it. It's like it's shrink-wrapped it. It's really very simple. Here's the Hirschfeld surface map with a function that we've defined. And poking out of it is actually an electron density surface of the molecule. That is from a quantum mechanical calculation. So they're kind of similar, but they're not the same as other representations. Now I put down here CPK. It stands for Corey Pauling Colton. Pauling, of course, being Linus Pauling. It's a common model that's used to describe and visualize molecules, and certainly was for a long time. And for those who know what that means and have used it, I put in here a paper from a Review of Scientific Instruments in 1953. Yeah. Molecular Models of Amino Acids, Peptides, and Proteins by Corey and Pauling. And they actually described making these models. Many people here will have played with these things. And Colton, actually, in 1965, took out a patent on making these things. Of course, it's utterly useless now, because even if it hadn't expired, because almost everything is done on the computer these days. But at that time, this was the state-of-the-art representation of molecules. Back to Hirschfeld surfaces. What have we done with them? The surface is defined by the molecules around it. It's smooth, it's differentiable. You can map all sorts of colors, all sorts of things on it. For every point on the surface, you can actually talk about the distance to the nearest nucleus inside. You can talk about the distance to the nearest nucleus outside. You can talk about combinations of them. You can normalize them by what are called van der Waals, or normal constant separations between molecules. And you can get all sorts of information about what is going on. It's a visual way of looking at what's going on with molecules and crystals. You can map properties of the surface itself, the curvature. This one in particular tells us something about whether it's concave, red, or convex, blue. And obviously, because these surfaces in crystals touch but never overlap, a concave part of one molecule must fit into a convex part of another one, and so forth. We can look at curvedness. This is effectively a root mean square curvature, and it tells us, if you like, where surface patches can be identified on molecules, where one molecule is in contact with another. We can play around with distances. You can't always produce nice, pretty pictures of molecules in journals. It's expensive, or they don't turn out that well. But you can use these distances and create a histogram, and you can bin the data across the whole surface and represent a combination of DE, DI, these internal and external distances, and map them, and they come out to be what we've actually characterized as a fingerprint. So in other words, these are five different molecules in two different polymorphs, two different crystal structures of one molecule. The point is you can actually identify features due to hydrogen bonds. You can identify features due to stacking of molecules, one on top of the other, like this. You can identify weaker hydrogen bonds. It's very easy to do that. And the really nice thing about it is that it's absolutely unique for any molecule in any particular crystal. We can break down the surface. We can look at patches associated with just OH contacts, contacts between oxygen and hydrogen and so forth. And then you can build up a picture, a map of what's going on. We can map the electrostatic properties of the molecule on the surface. And this is just a mapping of a property called the electrostatic potential, which actually characterizes regions which are, if you like, negatively charged or relatively negatively charged and relatively positively charged. This is just to give you an idea of how these five different molecules in two polymorphs of a different molecular crystal, the electrostatics changes as you literally rotate this particular functional group in the molecule. But it's just a quick and easy way of showing these sorts of ideas. So here's the plug. No, it's not really. We don't need to plug it. This is the software that we've developed. Why am I putting this up here? Because this underpins absolutely everything that we've been doing. It's a research tool, and I want to talk near the end, as I go through some of these examples, about energy frameworks. But these are the people who have been responsible for doing the work. I've written none of this. I've written none of the code. I just talk to people like Mike and Dylan and say, how about doing this? So Dylan's been a colleague for a long, long time here at UWA. He's a fantastic quantum chemist and absolutely amazing at what he can write. Josh McKinnon did an honours and a PhD with me at the University of New England, and he came here to do a postdoc and worked a lot on Crystal Explorer. And Mike Turner, who's here as well, has been working with me for the last, 5 years, something like that. But it's been fantastic. And of course, we had some nice funding from UNE, UWA, and the Australian Research Council. Once they realised that we had something worth funding, they decided to fund it. So I want to show you some applications of this. Software is not really important at the moment, it's what you can do with it. And because it's a research tool, it's fun to just explore what you can do. So, some historic molecular crystals. I've got to talk about X-ray crystallography. That's what we're talking about here, the International Year of Crystallography. This is Bragg's paper from 1913. W.L. Bragg, Lawrence Bragg. Lawrence Bragg was the son. It gave the first complete analysis of crystal structure by X-ray method, so that's why I said the International Year of Crystallography is a little bit late. He confirmed the structure of sodium chloride proposed by Barlow. In other words, he actually used X-ray diffraction methods. Now, it's important to notice at the time that W.L. Bragg here had a BA. He didn't even have a PhD, but he got the Nobel Prize. He was actually born in Adelaide, for those of you who don't know. He's Australian. He was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics, as it turns out, not chemistry, jointly with his father in 1915. And he was only in his early 20s. Now, this is a paper from 1949 of Lawrence Bragg, accepting something called the Roebling Medal of the Mineralogical Society of America. The Roebling Medal of that society is the top award that they give to scientists. And of course, Bragg wasn't really a mineralogist at all, and he acknowledges this in here. But it's really interesting what he said. This is 1949, so that's 30-odd years after he was awarded the Nobel Prize. And he said, when Lowy discovered X-ray diffraction, which is about 1912, my father was intensely interested because he'd speculated deeply on the nature of ionization by X-rays. So William Bragg, the father, who went to Adelaide, as the first professor of physics there and had a lot to do with the foundation of the University of Adelaide. Lawrence Bragg became interested through discussions with his father, but he acknowledges the decisive factor, as far as I was concerned, was a paper on Pope and Barlow's theory of valency volumes, which I haven't shown you. But this paper was given to a society of young scientists, and it introduced me to the geometry of three-dimensional structures and to such ideas as close packing of spheres. So what Bragg is actually saying there is that he didn't have an education that involved discussions of symmetry or close packing of spheres, yet he used that knowledge, after being presented with one example of it in a talk, to, if you like, solve the structure of sodium chloride, to put together all this information about the diffraction spots produced by a sodium chloride crystal and get the Nobel Prize. So it's that sort of insight that's quite fascinating. So this is actually the paper of Barlow and Pope's. And again, they're talking, this is from 1907, they're talking about the packing of these things. And again, they recognize that there are two ways of doing this, hexagonal and cubic. But what I found really fascinating is this. They go on a little bit further in the paper to say, when the elastic deformable spheres are employed instead of the hard spheres, and an equable pressure is applied in all directions to the assemblage, it's clear that the relative arrangement of the sphere centers survives the compression. In other words, you end up with precisely the same objects that we saw before. And Barlow and Pope didn't make a reference to Kepler. So these sorts of ideas have been discovered and rediscovered and rediscovered. But again, they recognize this idea that if you take regular arrangements of spheres and deform them due to pressure, you end up with an object like this, which, if you like, exhausts all space, but can be packed. Okay, that's the introduction to X-ray crystallography. Hexamethylbenzene is one of the three molecules I want to talk about. Why is that important? It's important because at the time this structure was done, there was still a lot of speculation about the nature of benzene, that is the structure, the shape, whether it was a planar molecule. Benzene's a very, very important molecule in chemistry, especially organic chemistry. It's a precursor to an enormous number of compounds. But there was a lot of speculation at the time about whether it was a planar molecule, whether it was actually hexagonal. Kathleen Lonsdale, one of the founding crystallographers, notice it's 1929, this is only 14 years after Bragg's Nobel Prize, and 16 years after his paper on sodium chloride. She studied hexamethylbenzene, and she studied hexamethylbenzene because benzene's a liquid at room temperature, whereas hexamethylbenzene is not. This is a different picture of Kathleen Lonsdale, and I think it's rather lovely. This is the 1948 Congress of the International Union of Crystallography, the first one they had, and here she is knitting on the beach. It's quite delightful, really. She said in her paper, and again, she goes back to Barlow and Pope, they suggested a structure for benzene in which the carbons were arranged in a zigzag or puckered hexagon. However, the power of X-rays has become known as an instrument for the analysis of crystal structures, and it's at once obvious that if the benzene nucleus existed as a distinct entity in the crystalline state, an accurate means of measuring and describing it was now available. So she's saying, use this new technique, let's answer this question. And it's quite fascinating to read this paper, because you wouldn't see a paper written like this these days. She said, here's the problem. Does the organic molecule exist as a separate entity in the crystalline state? This is 1929, it's not even a century ago.